In the days of World War II, the various and sundry leaders of the Axis and Allied powers all had their hand symbols. Joseph Stalin had the clenched fist as he ruled with the iron fist of USSR communism. Adolf Hitler had the outstretched palm. And Winston Churchill had the V for victory. What do you get? Rock, paper, scissors. And scissors always wins. Because the V for victory is also the peace sign. In the Bible, Paul's favorite title for God is that he is the God of peace. The way you get peace is by meditating on God. Isaiah says, "You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you." Philippians says that as you pray and are thankful, the peace of God will actually guard your heart. Romans says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." So turn your cares into prayers, your stresses into supplications, your worries into worship, and your fear into faith in your Father, and peace will come. To tell you that every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. This is Hope Generation and I'm Ben Courson. Whenever the devil reminds you of your past, you just remind him of his future. So let's partay and partake, not in the blues, but in the good news. God's been faithful in the past, so we're gonna be faith-filled about the future and we're gonna be fulfilled today. The Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, Winston Churchill, was perhaps the most skillful diplomat, statesman, and politician of the 20th century. And he was once asked, "What are the qualifications of becoming a great politician? What qualifications do you need to become a politician?" He said, "To become a politician, you need the ability to predict what's going to happen today. You need to predict what's going to happen tomorrow. You need to predict what's going to happen the day after that, the month after that, and the year after that. And then you have to be able to explain why it never happened." You have to have the ability to predict the future and then the diplomacy to explain to people why said future that you predicted never actually happened. Now, a lot of times we try to predict the future and it's always different than we thought it would be. I have never totally accurately predicted the future. And sometimes God doesn't meet my expectations because he plans to exceed my expectations because he does exceeding abundantly above all I could ever ask or think. No mind has conceived, no eye has seen, Paul said, no ear has heard what the Lord has in store for those who love him. We can't predict the future. And sometimes I think we like sit around trying to predict the future. We sit around wringing our hands about the future. But instead of wringing our hands, we should roll up our sleeves and get to work today. Sometimes we sit around waiting for a future opportunity to turn up when we just need to start with our sleeves. I'm waiting for an opportunity to turn up. Well, turn up your sleeves. I'm wringing my hands. Well, you can't roll up your sleeves and wring your hands at the same time. Sitting around trying to predict the future doesn't do any good because it's always different than you imagined it would be. The best way to predict the future is to create it. Come on. Would somebody please say church? The best way to predict the future is to create it. When you live well today, tomorrow will take care of itself. That was Jesus' argument in Matthew 6. He said, why are you worried about tomorrow? Birds don't build barns, and yet God takes care of them. The lilies of the valley don't spin or toil, and yet they're garbed more splendidly than Solomon in all of his glory. Why would you worry about tomorrow, Jesus said, when sufficient for the day is its own evil? You have enough problems to deal with today. If you live well today, tomorrow will take care of itself. So what we're going to talk about tonight is what the Bible has to say about not worrying about the future, getting past the past, and living in the now. This is something that God has been teaching me, like how to really live in the present, how to enjoy where I'm at on the way to where I'm going. We're going to really discuss tonight what the Bible has to say about living in the present. So please turn to Psalm chapter 118. Psalm 118 is actually the middle chapter of the Bible. It has the past behind it, the future in front of it, and yet it's directly in the middle of the Bible. And that's very fitting because this is a verse that teaches us how to live not in the past, not in the future, but just right in the middle, in the present. Present. So as we live in the presence of God, we live in the present moment, and this is what brings the greatest joy. Psalm chapter 118 will teach us this. And we're going to read out of verse 24. Psalm 118, verse 24. If you're there, would you please say, Oogway the turtle? Because I'm going to reference him in just a second. Psalm 118, verse 24 says, this is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in, say it out loud, it, not tomorrow, not yesterday, this day. This is the day. Today is the day the Lord has made. So we will rejoice and be glad in it. We're going to enjoy today. We're going to enjoy this present moment. We're going to rejoice and be glad in this moment that we have. The truth is a lot of us either try to live in the future or we try to live in the past. Have you ever noticed? Few women admit their age because they don't want to be their present age. Few women admit their age. Few men act it. Did I just get applause for a joke? This just made my day. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Either we don't want to admit our age or we don't act our age. We're always trying to be at a different age. So I want to talk to like all ages. Maybe you're here and you're feeling like, man, I'm getting older. And I wish I could go back to the glory days of yore, the elder times when I was the quarterback of Eagle Point High School or whatever. Like, man, I feel like I'm getting old and I have gray hair. Can I tell you something about a gray head? This is what the Bible says about your gray head. The book of Proverbs says, a gray head is a crown of glory. A hoary head, meaning a silver head, is a crown of glory when it is gained in the way of righteousness. So your gray head, according to the Bible, is actually a crown of glory. So even if, was that from Scott Madsen? I love your face, Scott Madsen. So a gray head is a crown of glory. And even when you get a gray head, you can still have passion in your heart. You may have snow on the rooftop, but you can have fire in the furnace. You say, but Ben, you don't understand. I'm getting old. I'm getting old. I have no purpose. As long as you got a pulse, you got a purpose. A gray head, the Bible says, is a crown of glory. One of my favorite examples is Caleb. This guy just blows my mind. When he was 45, he was one of the two spies, him and Joshua, who scoped out the promised land, and they said, "This is awesome. We loved the promised land. Let's take on the Anakim giants." But the 10 spies, nobody remembers their names. Even though they're recorded in the Bible, they were fearful and therefore forgettable. And they came back and they said, "Oh, the giants are too big. We're like grasshoppers in their eyes." And Caleb said, "No, they're just bread for us." He magnified God and minimized his giants. He said, "They're just bread. We're going to eat them up." But the other 10 spies were like, "No, we're going to magnify our problems and minimize the Lord," even though Psalm says to magnify the Lord. And they magnified their problems so big that they said, "We're just like grasshoppers compared to these giants." So there's Caleb magnifying the Lord, saying, "Oh, they're but bread for us. The Lord can save by many or by few," the Bible says. Genesis 18, "Is anything too hard for the Lord?" Jesus said, "Nothing is impossible with God. All things are possible to them who believe." So he's like, "Let's go into the promised land. Let's go into Canaan. Let's go to the land flowing with milk and honey." And I love this. He has to wait for 40 years for all of the old people to die off before he could go in with the young bucks, just him and Joshua. They were the only ones from their generation that were allowed into the promised land in their old age because they had faith and they kept the faith. They finished their course. They fought the good fight, as Paul said. So here's Caleb, right? He'd been faithful to God. And when he's 85 years old, after wandering in the desert for 40 years with his murmuring, unbelieving companions, when he's 85 years old, he gets his choice of any territory in the promised land. Like, he can choose any territory. Joshua was doling out different portions of the promised land. If I was Caleb at 85, this is exactly what I would say. "I'm 85. I fought my battles. I was in the promised land with Joshua, waging war against all kinds of Canaanites and Jebusites and Perizzites and Hittites and Amalekites and Flashlights and Termites and Millerites and all kinds of ites. I was just fighting them. So now it's time for me to retire." And I would say, "Joshua, I choose the beach condo on the coast of Galilee." That's what I would say. I'd say, "Give me the beach condo on the Sea of Galilee, please. Thank you." But you know what he says? Caleb says, "Don't give me the beach condo in Galilee." He says, "Give me Hebron, where the Anakim giants are." And he says, I love this, "I am as strong at 85 as I was at 45. They are but bread for us." Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." And Paul says, through him, we can do all things as he strengthens us. Caleb says, "They're but bread for us." And at 85 years old, I can't wait to see this heavenly DVD. Snow on the rooftop, fire in the furnace. I don't know what he was doing. Best movie scene, fight scene, maybe ever. Attack of the Clones, when Yoda comes hobbling in on his geezer stick. Nobody had ever seen him with a lightsaber. He just hobbles in with his geezer stick. He's like, "Dooku, to the dark side you have turned." And then pulls out his lightsaber and's flipping around and just the best fighter ever. I don't know if that's what Caleb was doing, just walking up with his geezer stick and then like Princess Bride or Yoda just flipping around, using his cane to bat people over the head. Giants, Anakim giants. "Give me the giants. Give me Hebron. Give me the mountains. I want to fight." Or maybe he was on his like walker. You know how walkers have like tennis balls at the bottom? You know how walkers have tennis balls at the bottom? Like maybe just walking up the mountain to the Anakim giants and like taking the tennis balls off and just chucking them at the Anakim giants. "Go down, Anakim. Go down. Game, set, match." I don't know what he did, but Paul said, "Where I am weak, his strength is made perfect." And here's, I would love to see if they ever made a video game of the Bible. I would love to see like a Marvel tag team between David and Caleb. Because Caleb was an 85-year-old who fought giants, and David was a little kid who fought giants. So here's like this 15-year-old who calls a Philistine giant, "You're uncircumcised." And then here's this 85-year-old in his walker who says, "They are but bread for us." They'd just be an awesome Marvel tag team, I'm just saying. But if I were Caleb, I would say, "Give me the condo in Galilee, not Hebron where the Anakim giants are." But that's not what Caleb said. I would have said, "I just want to watch reality TV until I die. I just want to distract myself and then I die." It's interesting. I read this quote a few years ago that really helped me. Nobody has ever been more distracted than our generation. If you are wondering why there are no more C.S. Lewis's in the world, no more stories as good as Tolkien's, No cathedrals as great as the Gothics. No music as moving as Paco Bells. It may be because the writers of these books, the tellers of these stories, the architects of these buildings, and the composers of these symphonies are sitting on their couches watching television. Either we're gonna applaud God or no golf claps. Is this clappable? Can we like give God some praise? But Caleb didn't say, I'm just gonna distract myself. I'm just gonna watch reality TV, enjoy my 401k, go senile and then die off. That's not what he said. Caleb was a beast, man. So whether you're Caleb at 85 years old or David at 15 years old, no matter what stage of life you're at or age of life you find yourself in, as long as you got a pulse, you still got a purpose. This is the day. Whether you're 85 or 15, this is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Let me share with you a really deep quote. The great, great, great theologian, Ugwe the Turtle, once said, yesterday is history. He told Poe the Kung Fu Panda. I just wanted to like hug Poe. Wasn't his name Poe the Fat Panda? Oh, I just love Poe. He told Poe, yesterday is history. Tomorrow is a mystery. But today is a gift. That is why it is called the present. Somebody say church. But actually, that is very true. That's what the psalmist is actually saying in Psalm 118. Today is a gift. Be glad in it. This is the day. That's why it's called the present. This is the day the Lord has made. Every good and perfect gift, James 1:17 says, comes from above, from the Father of lights, in whom there is no shadow of turning. Rejoice and be glad in this day. That's why we need to do a little bit more mindfulness, like really living in the present moment. The Bible from cover to cover really encourages living in the present. Our verse says, this is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Jesus said, do not worry about tomorrow. The Bible says, now is the day of salvation. The Bible says, God is an ever-present help in time of trouble. At the burning bush, Moses, when he asked who God was, God didn't say, I am the great I was. He said, I am the great I am. He's the God of the present. The Bible says that Paul the apostle said, brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting what's behind and reaching forth unto what's before, I press on toward the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. In the Greek language, it's the word epektein ominos, which is a really epic word. It's the word used of a runner sticking out his chest at the end of the finish line to shave off a microsecond from his time. Now, the problem with me when I ran track was I wasn't fast. And also, I would always look behind me. I would always look back. I wouldn't forget about what's behind. I'd always look behind to see how many people were behind me, and there was never anybody there. But Paul says, he uses this track term, I epektein ominos. I reach forth to what's before and I forget what's behind. I've got to learn to get past the past as I run the race of faith with endurance. I've got to get past my past and predict the future by creating it today. You say, Ben, I can't get past my past because you don't know what I did in my past. Well, this is what the Bible says about your past. The new covenant is that God declares, you are my people. This is from Hebrews. I am your God. Your sins and iniquities, I will remember no more. God's really good at forgetting the past. God is the God of the present, the I am. And he says, I forget about your past regarding your sins and iniquities. I will remember them no more. Don't let your identity be anchored to the ground by something you did or something you said in the past. There's no reason why you need to remain there. The Bible says you are a new creature. The Bible says, behold, in Isaiah, I do a new thing. Jesus says, I make all things new. Jesus says, I'm bringing new wine that must go into new wineskins. 1 John says, behold what manner of love the Father has given in us that we should be called the sons of God. That's our new identity. We're children of God. So we can get past our past. We also don't have to worry about the future. We don't have to worry about what's ahead. Listen to what God said in Isaiah about not being anxious about the morrow or trying to like run away from your problems of the future. Isaiah chapter 30, verse 15 and 16. For thus saith the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest shall ye be saved. In quietness and confidence shall be your strength. And ye would not. But ye said, no, for we will flee upon horses, therefore shall ye flee. And we will ride upon the swift. Therefore they that pursue you be Taylor Swift. I mean Swift. So you're saying, Israelites, we have so many problems, we're not gonna rest, we're just gonna be an anxious presence in the world, and we're gonna ride upon our horses and try to outrun our problems. And God's like, if you try to outrun your problems, they're gonna be swifter than you are. I'm gonna be swift, I'm gonna take care of my problems, I'm gonna outrun my problems. No, turn back and face your problems, or else your problems will be swifter than you. That's what God's saying. And God's saying, if you'll just listen, rest, you'll be saved. In returning and rest, when it comes to your future, rest. In returning and rest shall ye be saved. In quietness and confidence shall be your strength. Be still and know that he is God. He will be exalted among the heathen. He stills the storm, so be still and know that he is the God of that storm, and the God who calls you to it will bring you through it. Just return to me and rest. Be quiet and confident. What's he saying? Be a non-anxious presence in the world. Don't wring your hands. Don't sweat bullets. Just relax. This is the day the Lord has made. This. Be a non-anxious presence in this moment in the world today. And notice what he says at the second half of our verse. Look down at your Bible if you would. In verse 24 at the end, he says, we will rejoice and be glad in it. So what does living in the present do? It gives you the ability to rejoice and it gives you the ability to be glad. When you're living in the present moment, it's always people who have mindfulness. It's always people who live in the present. It's always people who imitate the great I am, people who don't try to be the I will be or the I was. They live in regards to who they are today. Those are the people that always rejoice the most. Those are the people that are always the happiest. Not the people who are hung up on their past, not the people who are anxious about the future, just the people who are living in this day. They're the ones who are glad. Psalm 4:7 says, thou hast put gladness in my heart more than in the time that their corn and their wine increased. God, you put gladness in my heart. The Bible says in Psalms, you put off my sackcloth and you gird me with gladness. God wants to give you gladness right now, in this moment, in this Bible study. Because I'll tell you this, you know how our verse says, we will rejoice and be glad right now in this day. I believe the enemy is always trying to get you to like procrastinate your joy. I believe that if the devil can't stop you from serving God, he'll just try to make you miserable while doing it. If the devil can't stop you from serving God, he'll try to make you miserable while you're doing it. I'm not saying if you're anxious or if you're hung up in your past that you're a bad person. We all struggle with this. I do all the time. What I'm saying is we can serve God, but if we're miserable doing it, I think we're not experiencing total victory. If the devil can't stop you from serving God, he'll try to make you miserable while doing it. Psalm says, we're gonna be glad. You've put off my sackcloth and given me gladness. We have more gladness in our heart than they have when their corn and wine increases. I will be glad and rejoice in today. Sometimes I think we get so obsessed with the devil who's trying to take away our joy. I heard this preacher, it killed me. This preacher was talking about the devil. It was the funniest thing. He's like, I hate the devil. You know, like, I don't know if you're Southern Baptist or something, but I hate the devil. Oh, the devil, he is so bad. The devil is so wicked, I hate the devil. The devil's so bad that if you take the D off of devil, what do you get? You get the word evil. Oh, the devil is evil. Oh, the devil is so bad, I hate the devil. The devil is so bad that if you take the E off the word evil, what do you get? You get the word vile. Oh, the devil is vile.
I hate the devil. The devil's so bad, I hate the devil. The devil's so wicked, I can't stand the devil. He's so bad, he's so vile that if you take the V off of vile, what do you get? You get the word ill. Ooh, the devil makes me ill. And if you take the I, ooh, I hate the devil. Oh, I can't stand the devil. And if you take the, he's so bad. If you take the I off of ill, what do you get? You get L. Ooh, if you listen to the devil, you're going to go to L.
Christians don't have to worry about demon possession. They have to worry about demon obsession. I'm serious. We don't have to worry about demon possession. We have to worry about demon obsession. Did you know in the Bible when Mike, this is such a weird passage and it's cool. In Jude, Jude talks about this story of Michael the archangel fighting over the body of Moses with the devil. And he didn't even rebuke the devil. He didn't trash talk the devil. He just said, the Lord rebuke you. He's like, I'm not even going to pay attention to you. I'm going to focus on God. Me and my sister, when we were growing up, it was so funny. We would sit at our front step at our house, and we would just spit on the ground because we thought, like, the devil was underneath the concrete, like, below. We'd spit on the ground. We'd go, oh, I hate the devil. Oh, the devil is so bad. He's so vile. He's so evil. And my dad would come out, and I was, like, expecting to be praised. Like, yes, I'm cursing the devil. And he's like, Ben, why would you focus on the devil when you can focus on the Lord? We give him too much attention. The Lord rebuke you. I'm focusing on God. I'm going to be glad today. I'm not going to let you take my joy today. That's what you want me to do. You want me to go through life miserable, not living in the present. I'm not giving in. I'm not going to have demon obsession or demon possession, because this is all I'm going to say. Greater is he that is within me than he that is within the world. That's what John the Apostle said. He is greater than you. So I'm not going to focus on you. I'm not going to focus on the darkness. I'm going to just turn on the light. And I'll tell you what the devil is trying to do. Whatever you call him, whether it's an evil force or the dark side or the devil or whatever, the adversary, the Satan, the enemy is always trying to get you to not live in the present by reminding you of your past or telling you you have no future. But listen, don't miss this. Every, do I have your attention? Every, will you incline your ear to my cry? Every, are you with me? Every saint has a past. And every sinner has a future.
Friends, I know sometimes it seems like God doesn't meet your expectations. But if God always met your expectations, how would he be able to exceed them? He is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we could ask or even think, according to the power that is at work within us. So if you'd like some more hope content, to get some hope quotes, to see some short films, to listen to our national radio broadcast, or to even see previous TV episodes, visit bencourson.com. While there, make sure, if you feel so led, to donate to our program if you would like to invest in this next generation. Until next time, we will see you later, Hope Generators.